Hi, everybody. It's Dr. Carolyn Coker-Ross. And today we're going to be talking about self-compassion beyond food and body image, or what I like to call how to stop trying to hate yourself thin. And I'm going to talk to you about what is the definition of self-compassion and why is self-compassion important. And then I'll give you three things that you can do to start developing self-compassion. So let's get started. Many people, maybe like you, if you have binge eating disorder, emotional eating, or food addiction, you probably aren't consciously aware that you're trying to hate yourself then. But if you have behaviors such as food obsessions, chronic dieting, a lot of negative body talk or body dissatisfaction, deprivation, can't eat that, it's bad for me, quote unquote, these are all examples of how you may be trying to hate yourself thin. This desire to hate yourself thin that comes from the unconscious belief that if I'm hard on myself, then I won't gain weight. Or if I'm hard on myself, I can fill in the blank, whatever your goal is or whatever the New Year's resolution is that you've already set up. But what we know is you can't really hate yourself thin. So some people feel like, oh, well, maybe I'm just not being hard enough on myself. Well, that doesn't work as well either. So if you recognize yourself in this description, now's the time to ask yourself, is this working for me? Is this really working? And if it's not, then you may want to try a different approach. So being nice to yourself, particularly, especially during a personal setback or stressful experience, is what's known as self-compassion. So there's your definition of self-compassion. Being nice to yourself, especially during stressful situations or personal setbacks. So I'll give you an example for myself. I recently was very privileged to give a TEDx talk in Texas, in Pleasant Grove, Texas. And after the talk, I felt a lot of insecurity and was worried maybe I didn't do as well as I thought I had. I should have done better. I don't know if you've ever been in a situation like that where you feel like maybe you failed in your performance in some way. But so that went on in my head, and I started to notice how miserable it was making me. And then I just stopped and stepped back and was able to realize, you know, this was a huge goal that I accomplished. And not only that, but I did the best I could. So that's an example of how even in a stressful situation, you can be nice to yourself, because continuing to beat myself up was not going to change what goes up on TED.com. And I'll let you know the link when it comes out. And you can be the judge yourself. So part of this self-compassion is seeing yourself in a new light as someone going through a process or being on a journey. And if you can see that all the challenges and all of what you may have called failures along the way are all just part of the process or the journey, it may help you recognize that what's ahead of you on your journey is up to you, and it's all part of the process. So sometimes we're quick to judge when something happens. Oh, this isn't what I expected, so it should have been different. But usually those times, or oftentimes those times, can bring even better results than what we had hoped for if we just don't get stuck in wanting it to look a certain way. And the most important thing to know is that research shows that if you respond to life's difficulties with self-compassion, this can reduce depression, stress, performance anxiety, and body dissatisfaction. And it can also increase happiness, self-confidence, and immune function. Who doesn't want that? And the most important person to have compassion for is who? It's you. It's yourself. The deepest healing that you can ever have is really awakening to who you truly are, your authentic self. And your authentic self and being accepting of that has to do with seeing yourself as you really are, your flaws and your mistakes, but seeing those with compassion. When this happens, you will find yourself moving beyond just the focus on behaviors or appearance. So just beyond the binging, the number on the scale, the emotional eating. And over time, as you come to know yourself better and better, you can maybe be able to stop judging your past and accept those character flaws. And then you will feel more compassion towards other people as well. So just give it some thought, will you? So if you want to start working on self-compassion, here are three ways that you can do that. Number one, first, you must notice your own suffering. Admit the pain you feel from binge eating, compulsive overeating, emotional eating, and food addiction. So that's just saying, yes, I am in pain. I'm suffering. And number two, open your heart to accept and notice the suffering that your eating behaviors have caused. So this is saying, I accept that no matter what I do, I'm still binging. And this is a source of huge amount of suffering and pain for me. And then number three, the Buddhists say that pain is part of the human condition. This means none of us are perfect and all of us deserve compassion and understanding. So many people, especially with eating issues, love to compare themselves to other people and say, well, you know, if I looked like her, then I would be more deserving. And if I just keep beating myself up, maybe I can get there. But it really doesn't work that way. So all of us deserve compassion and understanding, no matter what the number on the scale is, no matter whether you followed your theoretical perfect diet plan or not. No matter what's happening in your life, we all deserve compassion and understanding. So I'd love to give you a little exercise. I'd encourage you to have a journal handy after you're listening to the podcast and just write down two ways in which you can treat yourself with more compassion. Now, many people who have trouble feeling self-compassion can imagine being compassionate towards a small child or a pet, especially a beloved child or a beloved pet. So if you can think of how you can give yourself the same care you would give to a small child or a pet, that would be a great way for you to start developing self-compassion. So I'm encouraging you to do this exercise and see where you get. Okay, so next week we're going to be talking about learning to have compassion with myself for who I am. Learning to have compassion with myself for who I am. Please subscribe to my channel and turn on your notifications so you can find out when the next video is being posted right away. I really appreciate your listening. This is The Work of Recovery. Thank you.